Emerging markets, BRIC, Brazil, Russia, India, China. Clearly, the economy of the world is shifting from the U.S. to all these economies. And John Stephenson, the author of Shell Shocked, is going to tell us how Canadians can play that market. Welcome back, John.
Thank you very much.
So we talked earlier about the decline of U.S., the rise of Canada, and but in particular, you're very enthusiastic about emerging markets, and particularly the BRIC nations. And of those four BRIC nations, Brazil, Russia, India, China, is it China that you find the most significant?
Well, China's the most compelling, you know, argument to be made for the rise. It's just been very dramatic in terms of their growth as an economy and as a country. And I think really, when you go to China, what blows you away is just how progressive it is. I mean, sure, the system...
You've been there yourself?
I've been there myself, and I was absolutely flabbergasted. I think probably the only caution I would give to viewers is that when you go, you're so excited, you may be overexcited when you see what's really happening on the ground.
And conversely, when you talk about the BRICS, you're not that big a fan of Russia.
I think Russia, it really is a gangster capitalist model. I think it's hard to see real economic growth. The state has intervened in many cross-border transactions, whether it's Gazprom shutting off gas to Georgia and other places, whether it's with BP and their project, the Sakhalin project. It goes on and on, and I think you'd have to scratch your head about throwing in investment dollars at Russia.
Unfortunately, if you buy a BRIC fund or an emerging markets fund, they're going to give you a little Russia anyway.
Well, and I think that's why you have to be able to distinguish. It was very clever marketing on the part of Goldman Sachs to coin that, and I think not all the BRICS are equal. I think you really have a disparity. I don't think India is even the same category necessarily as China in terms of growth rate. You know, India will be, you know, lucky to clock in at 6% growth rate, which seems pretty good when we're doing two or three here in Canada. But where the growth is going to come from is really China, which is going to be north of 8.
But you don't see, I mean, I see India as, you know, sort of like British Commonwealth, the language, democracy, rule of law, etc. When I think about, the gangster state in Russia, I think China is a little bit like that insofar as, you know, they're pirating the intellectual software of all the rest of the world. But you still think China is more valid than Russia in any case?
Well, I would say so. First of all, you have these oligarchs who got to power by supporting, the existing incumbency, and they pirated off all these state assets that are worth billions of dollars in many cases. They're not investing in this infrastructure. It wasn't done at auction or anything that wasn't rigged. So I think that's a very different category. If you look at China, sure, it's a totalitarian regime. I wouldn't want to necessarily live there. But when you go there and you talk to people who are Chinese, they actually think it's a great system and they're happy. They're not happy because they think they can vote or they can't vote. What they're happy about is they see economic progress. I think India has promise, but there's 4,000 political parties. There's no consensus. And there's a legacy of socialism that was really developed under Nero. So there's a huge legacy issues in India. It will take them time to get it together.
The people often debate whether you should invest directly in these emerging markets or sort of invest through the foreign multinationals in North America, for example, that are also themselves going into those emerging markets. You obviously believe a bit of both.
Yeah, I think you're welcome to take a fairly passive approach, invest in ETFs that are linked to those countries. I think that's where it is. I think the simple math is really this. There's 1 billion people in the West who have an affluent standard of life, and there's 5 billion people in the developing world, and all the future growth is pretty much going to come from that because global population is going to hit 8.5 billion people soon, and all that growth is to the developing world. They're going to eventually, over time, have what we have. You've just got to figure out what they want. They do want some luxury goods. They do want some Coca-Cola. They do want some McDonald's. They do want to, I was very surprised to see how popular KFC was, for example, throughout Asia. It's surprising because I consider that a brand that's in decline here in North America, but it's doing great business overseas.
The thesis of Canada rising, you could equally argue Australia rising because they're similar economies. They've done great. They've already raised their interest rates three times. Plus, of course, Australia is closer to those Asian tigers. Do you think Canadians should basically have as much exposure to Australia as they have to Canada based on those arguments?
I think Australia is certainly a place to look, and I think New Zealand, you could make the same argument. South Africa, you could make them. Any resource country, you could make that argument because so much of what's being demanded is resources for this industrialization and urbanization. But I will point out a key difference. They don't have oil in any of those three countries. And that's a huge, it's the most liquid and biggest commodity there is by far. So I think you're still better off to play Canada, but certainly I think all the currencies and the stock markets of those countries will go higher in the intervening 5 to 10 years.
Okay, in our last minute here, let's put it all together for investors.
Sure.
And let's imagine just the equity slice. So let's say you're 100% equities, bonds are sitting there on the mm-hmm. side. How do you play this? I mean, it used to be you'd be like a third U.S., a third Canada, mm-hmm. and a third international emerging markets. You're saying underweight Europe and U.S.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you could go for a weighting of 15% or so for both the U.S. and Europe.
So 30 right. total between the
yeah,
two of them.
With 30 between the total. Frankly, they're just too old. There's no growth, and they're not linked to where the action is. Maybe 35% for the developing world and Canada as an indirect way to play the developing world. At lower risk. I think those are the reasons you want to do it. Canada isn't perfect. We haven't done everything right, but our growth is linked to global growth.
So to summarize, 35% of your equities in Canada, mm-hmm. 35% in BRIC emerging markets, mm-hmm. 15% in the U.S., and 15% in old Europe.
Yes, absolutely.
There you have it. All you need to know. Thank you very much, John Stephenson, author of Shell Shocked.